morning, folks. Welcome to St. Matthew's for online Sunday worship for February 7th. We're so glad that you've chosen to join with us today in praise and worship to God and coming together as a community, this beautiful gathering of the body of Christ. Thank you for being here. We're so glad to see you. I have a few announcements, quite a few actually, that I want to share with you today. Take a look at your bulletins, not only because the cover image is important for today, but also because there's some great announcements in there. First off, there's an announcement about Lent and upcoming Lenten programming. Be aware that we will have Ash Wednesday services both online and in person. There'll be an online Ash Wednesday service that starts up that early that morning of Ash Wednesday, the 17th. And then there will be an in-person option available for folks as well that evening. We're not allowed to impose ashes this year, so that kind of threw us a little bit of a curveball to do something different. So instead, what's going to happen is that we're going to have small packets of ashes prepared for folks to pick up. If they're going to be joining us for the online service ahead of time, you'll be able to pick those up the Sunday prior. And a couple days prior to that, when the office is open, just like you might pick up a home communion kit for yourself, you'll be able to pick up those ashes for Ash Wednesday. I'll have a little Q-tip in there, and you'll be able to impose those ashes on yourself during that service if you choose to do so. It's not a requirement of any kind. It's an optional part of that liturgy, but it is, of course, very close to many of our hearts and to our practice. So if you'd like to do that, know that that will be available. Take a look at the announcement. If you choose to attend the in-person version of that service, there will also be those little packets for the self-imposition of ashes. I will not be doing that to you this year. You will be doing it to yourself. So just an FYI about that. Also, we've got some announcements about Lenten programming in there as well. Take a look at a couple of those great new options that Father Smith has prepared for us. One is an opportunity to reflect on the difficult times that we've had over the last year and how it's forced you to grow and to meet those challenges. That's the one called Turn Straw into Gold this Lent. Father Smith is also leading a book study on being Christian, written by Rowan Williams, the former Archbishop of Canterbury, and he'll be leading that during Lent as well this year. There are several other announcements that I want to make sure I point out to you, especially the children's ministry news about Children's Chapel and the offerings for Sunday school and those programs run by Amy. So take a look at that. New information about that in here this morning. Also, Amy's done an amazing little project to transform our pre-K room into a children's library and kind of a space for families to gather and spend some time when they're here. We'll have that open for one family at a time for a little while on Sunday mornings each week, and hope to kind of grow and expand that as folks are here and spending time on the campus in a safe way. So individual families can go in and use that space. We've got some photos of it posted on Facebook, and it's really cool. She just did such a lovely job, and I can't thank her enough and appreciate her ministry with us enough. Also, take a look there at House of Refuge, looking for some donations of furniture and kitchen items. That's one of those community partners that we have, and we love to participate with and work in ministry together. There's also a couple other announcements, one that's been there for a little while, about our Creation Care Committee that's being formed and some of the work that they are doing. There's a little announcement as you come in, a board with some information on it and a way to pick up some of those reusable grocery bags, which frankly are much better than the disposable ones. I hardly even have the disposable ones anymore because I just always use the reusable ones that you can carry so much more in them. So I find them to be superior in almost every way, in addition to being much more environmentally friendly. So lots of information in there today. Adult ed offerings coming up, liturgy coming up for Ash Wednesday and Lent. So much happening here at St. Matthew's. Thank you for being part of this beautiful place. Let's just take a moment, hear the still small voice of the Spirit in our hearts and minds this morning as we begin our worship together. Thank you. Yeah.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the
Let us pray. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth. When he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see, who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah! How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor him with praise. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to his wisdom. The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the harp. He covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass to grow upon the mountains and green plants to serve mankind. He provides food for flocks and herds and for the young ravens when they cry. He is not impressed by the might of a horse. He has no pleasure in the strength of a man. But the Lord has pleasure in those who fear him, in those who await his gracious favor. Hallelujah.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this, of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in his blessings. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to St. Mark. Jesus and his disciples left the synagogue at Capernaum and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. And then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. And that evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed, and Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." And he answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. So when was the last time that you built a sandcastle? For me personally, it was probably 30 years ago on a beach in South Carolina. But maybe you've had a more recent experience than that with your children or grandchildren. Maybe you even had a sandbox in your backyard at some point in your life. Sand is a great building material, isn't it? At least for short periods of time, it can be formed into all sorts of shapes. It can be manipulated in interesting ways. It's so fine, it can be carefully sculpted to show intricate detail. Every year, except this past one, of course, there's a U.S. sand sculpting challenge over in San Diego where artists create some of the most beautiful and elaborate sculptures that you can even imagine, all of it in sand. If you've ever wanted to see a 6-foot-tall statue of Stevie Wonder or a life-size rhino made entirely out of sand, you would have gone to the right place. Sand is good for this kind of work because it's so fine. It's an aggregate of tiny particles, rocks, minerals, shells, ground into minuscule size by centuries of wind and water. We experience sand only in a collective way, a handful or a bucket at a time. No one picks up an individual grain or collects each tiny pinprick for closer examination. But the amazing thing is that each grain is unique and different, in the same way that each snowflake, if you look closely enough, is different from every other snowflake. Each grain of sand was once something else and has its own identity, an identity that years of ocean waves or desert winds have worn away beyond our ability to experience. The cover of your bulletin today shows a drop of sand from a beach magnified 300 times under a powerful microscope. With different eyes, we can see that each grain possesses its own identity and origin, its own story, if you will. One is a piece of coral, another a fragment of shell, another a bit of mineral, all of which is invisible to the naked eye, but present just below our ability to perceive. So much of the natural world is like this, seemingly infinite and incomprehensible in its scale. You know, our galaxy alone is known to contain up to 400 billion stars. 400 billion stars, like the one that rises in the east every morning. And that's only the beginning. The universe as a whole may contain up to 2 trillion galaxies. 2 trillion. Is anyone out there really good at math? Can you multiply 400 billion times 2 trillion real quick for me? Anybody? No? How many zeros would there be at the end of that number? Do we even have words for numbers that are that big? That number, that unthinkable number, is a rough estimate of the number of stars in this universe. Do you know how many stars human beings have bothered to name? How many of those we've given a unique identity to? I would have guessed it would have been pretty high, but according to the International Astronomical Union, which hosts a working group on star names, there are 336 stars with proper names. Did you hear that? There are something like 400 billion stars in this galaxy alone, 10,000 of which we can see with the naked eye in really good low light pollution areas. And in centuries of astronomical observation, we have named a grand total of 336 of them, officially at least. Folks, we have been slacking. The reason that this subject has caught my attention is because in today's readings, we hear not once but twice that while we may have been slacking on the job, God is way ahead of us. Lift up your eyes on high and see, the prophet Isaiah says, speaking of the stars in the sky. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name. Because he is great in strength and mighty in power, not one is missing. The psalm makes a very similar statement. He counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names. It's an incredible thing to think about, that each individual star, countless trillions of them, each and every one is named by their creator. Each has an identity known only to God. Each has a purpose ordained by the creator. Each has a role and function written into the very fabric of their being. Imagine taking a handful of sand and then naming each individual grain. It would probably take you all week, right? Now imagine naming every grain of sand on that beach in San Diego. Imagine naming every grain of sand on the entire California coast or the sand on all the world's beaches and deserts. That would not come close to the names given by God to each part of God's creation. He counts the number of the stars and calls them all by their names. How incredible is it that the creator of the universe, the Lord of heaven and earth, the high and lofty one who inhabits eternity, the great I am, knows each star by name. And what's more, he knows each of us by name. Not just us, but every part of us too. Jesus says in the Gospel of Luke, "Are not five sparrows sold for 2 pennies? Yet not one of them is forgotten in God's sight. But even the hairs of your head are all counted. Do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows." In the mind of God, even the sparrows are known, each and every one of them, and even the hairs of your head are counted. It would be tempting to view this cynically as a bunch of feel-good platitudes about a God who is distant from us, of whom we now see in a glass darkly. But I actually believe that the opposite is true. In a strange and compelling way, the fact that every star is named, every hair and grain of sand is counted, every sparrow is known to the mind of God, shows how deep is God's love for the creation. How much God cares, not just about the fiery immensity of stars or the unthinkable expanse of the galaxies in their courses, but also about us, about you. I've often wondered, you know, why Jesus' incarnation didn't happen in a more dramatic way. Why not arrive with more fireworks, Jesus, with a good communications team to spread the message, with angelic messengers to bring the gospel to the ends of the earth? Why not more show and more flash, huh? Why not more shock and more awe? I mean, you could say that if God wanted to spread the good news, he could have at least hired a PR firm, made a logo, worked on some message discipline, some brand identity, scheduled a book tour, maybe even had an aerial display of heavenly might to get people really motivated around the globe. Why not anything else but a peasant from Palestine? Literally anything else would have made a bigger splash. Couldn't Jesus have been someone more important, someone with a bigger loudspeaker, someone with millions of Twitter followers, someone with an image consultant and some nice suits? You know, there are many reasons why God did not speak to us in that way. I could talk to you at length about free will and choice and how a heavenly army would have removed that freedom from us entirely. I could talk to you about humility, how the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. I could talk to you about the ways in which that kind of incarnation is not biblically sound or theologically consistent. But let's not talk about it. Let's look instead. Today, Jesus is with Simon and Andrew and James and John, people he knows, people like you and me. He heals Simon's mother-in-law of a fever. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, we are told. Her, a peasant woman much like himself, an individual. He heals the people that the villagers bring to him. One by one, he lays hands on them. Individuals, each with their own problems, their own needs, their own sins, their own grief. Jesus looks each of them in the eye, and he calls them by name. Do you see, folks? It's small, it's intimate. It expresses love and care as for one's family. If Jesus came with a megaphone and a PR firm, he wouldn't be Jesus. We're talking about a God who names each and every star, trillions upon trillions of them, who calls us by name, who knows the number of hairs on our heads. It's a paradox for sure, but it says a great deal about God, about the incarnation, that he can at the same time be the creator of all that is and a person like us, who lived for a few short decades in a very unremarkable place and in a very limited time, just as we do. Again, it's a sign of the truth of the incarnation that he was who he was. Christ arriving with hosts of heaven in his retinue would not be fully human. Christ without the love and care for individuals that he showed would not be fully God. Christ speaking from the clouds in glory would not be human like us. Christ without healing power would not be God. Jesus is both God and man at the same time, both limited and unlimited, both as far from us as the stars and as near as the whisper of a friend. The love and concern he showed for the people in these stories about his life is a witness not only to his humanity, but to his divinity as well. Note how the psalm speaks of God in that same way, how it unites those two disparate images. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds, and then in the next verse it says, he counts the number of the stars and he calls them all by their names. The two go together. Only God could do both. Only God could be both. So the next time you look at the sand of the desert or the beach, and the next time you gaze at the infinity of the heavens above us, remember that each and every one is known and named by God. And if that's true, how much more does that same God know and love you? He who spoke creation into being in a blaze of glory will also come and take you by the hand and lift you up. For he knows your name and he is calling you even now. Holy Lord God, you are so great and awesome and mighty, and yet you stoop down to be like one of us. To dwell with us, to be in our hearts and souls and spirits. Lord God, we thank you for the love and concern you show for all creation, and especially for your love towards us, in sending Jesus Christ to live among us and to create for us the way of salvation. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made. Of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone. For this community, the nation, and the world. For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace. For the just and proper use of your creation. For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression. For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy. For the peace and unity of the Church of God. For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth. For Michael, our presiding bishop, and Jennifer, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers. For all who serve God in his church. For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King, and praise your name forever and ever. We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them who put their trust in you.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. Each little flower that opens, each little bird that sings, God made their glowing colors and made their tiny wings. The purple-headed mountains, the rivers running by,
sunset and the morning that brightens up the sky. The cold wind in the winter, the pleasant summer sun, the ripe fruit in the garden, God made them every one. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, the Lord God made them all. God gave us eyes to see them, and lips that we might tell. How great is God Almighty, who has made all things well. All things bright and beautiful, the Lord God made them all.
As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Go into the world in peace. Be strong and of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted, support the weak, help the afflicted, honor all people. Love and serve the Lord with gladness, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you this Sunday and always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Our hearts are as pure. Thank you.